observable universe. The phrase alone stirs a certain curiosity, does it not? It speaks to both the triumph of human ingenuity and the humility forced upon us by our own limitations. We stand at a point in history where we can claim to have measured the heavens, charted galaxies billions of light years away, and mapped the faint echoes of creation itself. And yet, we remain as much in the dark as our ancestors, staring into the night from the flickering warmth of their campfires. What is the observable universe? To answer that, let us imagine a bubble, a vast luminous sphere surrounding our tiny planet. This bubble is not one of soap and water, but one of light. It is defined by the speed of light itself, the fastest thing in the universe, or so we believe. Everything within this sphere is visible to us because light from those objects has had time to reach us, traveling across the eons at an astonishing 300,000 kilometers per second. But beyond the bubble lies a darkness we cannot penetrate. Not because nothing is there, mind you, but because light from those regions has not yet arrived. This boundary, this edge, is not static. It grows larger with every passing moment as light from ever more distant stars continues its long journey to our telescopes. But there is a limit, a point where the expansion of the universe itself outpaces the speed of light. Imagine running toward the horizon. No matter how fast you go, it always recedes, always stays just out of reach. This is the cosmic horizon, the ultimate boundary of the observable universe. Beyond it, light cannot catch up to us, and so we are left to wonder, to dream, and perhaps to despair at the unknowable. I often think of this horizon as a kind of cosmic shoreline. We are like sailors, standing on the deck of a ship, gazing out at a seemingly endless ocean. We can map the waters immediately around us. We can drop a line and measure their depth. But the distant waves, those remain a mystery. And yet, like all good sailors, we are compelled to explore. The human spirit, after all, is not content with what is known. It craves the adventure of the unknown. But what lies beyond this cosmic shoreline? What lies beyond the observable universe? It is a question that has haunted astronomers and philosophers alike for centuries. Is it simply more of the same? More stars, more galaxies stretching on forever? Or is it something altogether different, something that defies the very laws of physics that govern our corner of existence? The observable universe is vast, some 93 billion light years across, but it is not infinite. And this distinction, I think, is where the mystery truly begins. If the universe is not infinite, then what lies outside it? A void? A wall? Or something so alien that our minds can scarcely conceive of it? And if the universe is infinite, as some suspect, what does that mean for us? Can we, finite beings on a finite planet, ever truly grasp the infinite? Or is the act of trying itself an act of hubris? These questions are not merely academic. They strike at the very heart of our existence. For to understand the universe is, in a sense, to understand ourselves. The cosmos is not separate from us. It is part of us. Every atom in your body was forged in the heart of a star. Every breath you take is connected to the great cosmic dance of matter and energy. To look outward is to look inward, to see the infinite reflected in the finite. And so, as we begin our journey into the mysteries of the observable universe, let us keep this duality in mind. We are explorers, yes, but we are also poets, philosophers, and dreamers. The edge of the known is not a wall, it is a doorway. And though we may never step through it, the act of approaching it, of asking what lies beyond, is itself a profound and beautiful endeavor. Now, let us turn to the science of this boundary, the mechanics of light, space, and time, and see how far our campfire of knowledge has pushed back the darkness. For only by understanding what we can see can we begin to imagine what lies beyond. The horizon. It's a word that carries weight, does it not? It conjures images of distant lands, of unseen adventures waiting just out of view. It is both a boundary and a beckoning, a line that separates what is from what could be. In cosmology, this word takes on a deeper significance. The cosmic horizon is not just the edge of sight, it is the edge of causality itself. Beyond it, the universe becomes an enigma. Now, what is this cosmic horizon, really? To understand, let us imagine a runner on a track. The runner is light, racing at its remarkable speed of 300,000 kilometers per second. The track, however, is not stationary. It is the fabric of space itself, and it is expanding. At first, the runner keeps pace, covering ground with ease. But as the track stretches faster and faster, the runner can no longer keep up. Eventually, the finish line, the point they are trying to reach, moves faster than they can run. This, in essence, is what happens at the cosmic horizon. The expansion of space accelerates to such a degree that light from distant galaxies can never reach us, no matter how much time passes. They are, quite literally, beyond our grasp. This might seem like a definitive barrier, an immutable line drawn by the laws of physics. But is it? Or might it also be an invitation to question, to imagine, to dream of what lies beyond? Consider this. If we accept the cosmic horizon as a boundary, we risk limiting our understanding of the universe. After all, the history of science is one of pushing past boundaries once thought unbreakable. Once, the edge of the Earth's horizon marked the end of the world. Sailors feared falling off its edge until bold explorers proved otherwise. Could the cosmic horizon be much the same, a line that seems insurmountable now, but may in time yield to new knowledge and technologies? Still, there is a tantalizing mystery to this boundary. Beyond it, the universe continues to expand, to evolve, to exist, unseen and untouched by us. What might it be like? Is it more of the same? Galaxies and clusters stretching on into infinity? Or does the fabric of space itself change, becoming something utterly alien? Here, I find myself drawn to the philosophical implications. The cosmic horizon is a reminder of our limitations, yes, but also of our capacity for wonder. It is a humbling thing to know that there are regions of the universe we will never observe, never measure, never understand. Yet it is also a call to imagination. If we cannot reach these places with our telescopes, then we must reach them with our minds. And so I ask you, what do you think lies beyond? A continuation of the familiar or the birthplace of the extraordinary? The horizon, you see, is not just a scientific concept. It is a mirror. It reflects our deepest desires and fears, our need to know and our fear of the unknowable. Perhaps this is why I hesitate to call the cosmic horizon a barrier. A barrier stops us. It confines us to what is. An invitation, on the other hand, draws us forward. It calls us to explore, to learn, to push against the limits of our understanding. And while we may never cross this particular horizon, the act of approaching it, the questions we ask, the answers we seek, enriches us all the same. Let us not forget, too, the profound beauty of this boundary. It is not an empty edge, a simple line where the universe stops. No, it is a living thing, shaped by the interplay of light, time, and space. It is a reminder that the universe is both vast and intimate, both comprehensible and deeply mysterious. And so, as we gaze toward this cosmic horizon, let us embrace both the science and the wonder it inspires. Let us measure its distance, its expansion, its shape. But let us also marvel at its mystery and allow ourselves the luxury of imagination. For the horizon, in all its forms, is where our greatest stories begin. Now, with the horizon in our sights, we turn to a mystery that lies near its edge, a mystery that challenges the very foundations of our understanding. Dark flow. What is it? What does it mean? And what might it reveal about the universe beyond? There is a certain romance in the idea of the unknown. It pulls at us like a siren song, urging us to peer into the dark corners of existence. And yet, every so often, the unknown pushes back. It brushes against the edges of our understanding, leaving behind a trace, a clue, faint but tantalizing. Such was the case in 2008, when astronomers stumbled upon a phenomenon so peculiar, so unexpected, that it shook the foundations of cosmology. They called it dark flow. Allow me to set the stage. At the time, scientists were poring over data from a remarkable instrument, the Wilkinson Microwave Anisotropy Probe, or WMAP for short. Its mission was to map the cosmic microwave background, the faint, ghostly afterglow of the Big Bang. This radiation, spread thinly across the universe, is like a cosmic fossil, a relic of the universe's earliest moments. It is quiet, almost imperceptible, yet it speaks volumes about the nature of our cosmos. Among those studying this data was a team of researchers led by Alexander Kashlinsky at NASA. Their goal was ambitious: to compare the motion of galaxy clusters with the patterns in the cosmic microwave background, searching for subtle clues about the forces shaping the universe. To do this, they relied on a fascinating phenomenon known as the kinematic Sunyaev-Zeldovich effect. When cosmic background radiation passes through a galaxy cluster, it gains a tiny boost of energy, a whisper of motion, if you will. By analyzing these whispers across multiple clusters, Kashlinsky's team hoped to uncover hidden patterns in the cosmic flow. What they found was astonishing. Hundreds of galaxy clusters spanning billions of light years appeared to be drifting in the same direction, toward a point near the constellations Centaurus and Hydra. This was no small motion. These clusters were traveling at speeds of up to 1,000 kilometers per second. And yet, there was nothing visible to account for this motion. No massive structure, no known gravitational force. It was as though something beyond the cosmic horizon, a place we cannot see, was pulling them like a tide drawing ships toward an unseen shore. This phenomenon was christened dark flow, and with it came a flood of questions. Could such a force truly exist beyond the observable universe? And if so, what might it be? The implications were staggering. For something beyond the horizon to exert such a pull, it would have to be unimaginably massive, a gravitational titan far larger than anything we know. And yet, it would lie entirely outside our field of vision, beyond the reach of light itself. Of course, science is a cautious discipline. For every discovery, there must be skepticism, rigor, and replication. And so, the scientific community began to probe this strange phenomenon, seeking to verify its existence and understand its nature. Some argued that dark flow could be a remnant of the universe's infancy, a gravitational echo from a time when all things were closer together. Others suggested it might be evidence of a multiverse, a hint that our universe is but one bubble in an infinite cosmic sea. And yet, not everyone was convinced. In 2009, the European Space Agency launched the Planck satellite, a successor to WMAP with even greater precision. Using Planck's data, another team of scientists re-examined the motion of galaxy clusters, searching for signs of dark flow. Their conclusion? They found no evidence of the phenomenon. The clusters, they claimed, were moving as expected, with no mysterious drift toward an unseen force. Kashlinsky and his team, however, were undeterred. They revisited the Planck data and insisted that dark flow was still there, albeit faint. The debate, as of now, remains unresolved. Is dark flow a genuine anomaly, a crack in the cosmic fabric? Or is it merely a mirage, a product of statistical noise and human interpretation? Only time and further study will tell. As I recount this story, I cannot help but feel a sense of wonder. Dark flow is not just a scientific puzzle. It is a reminder of the universe's boundless mystery. It challenges us to think beyond the limits of our knowledge, to question what lies beyond the veil of observation. And perhaps most importantly, it reminds us that the journey of discovery is as vital as the destination. For now, let us hold this mystery close, like a lantern in the dark. Let us marvel at the questions it raises and the possibilities it suggests. In the next step of our journey, we shall turn our gaze toward the forces that might give rise to such a phenomenon. What could be pulling these galaxies? And what does it tell us about the universe beyond? Imagine, if you will, a vast ocean, its surface calm and unbroken save for a single ripple, moving with quiet purpose. Now, imagine that ripple is not water, but galaxies, entire clusters of them, drifting through the cosmos, drawn toward a point we cannot see. What could cause such motion? What unseen hand tugs at these clusters, exerting a force so profound it reaches across billions of light years? To explore this question, one must confront the enormity of the possibilities. Whatever lies beyond the cosmic horizon, pulling these galaxies, must be vast, far larger and more massive than anything within our observable universe. And that is where the wonder begins. Not a single star, nor even a single galaxy, but something far greater, a gravitational titan, one might say, the likes of which we can scarcely imagine. Some might suggest that dark flow is an echo of a primordial event, a relic from the universe's infancy. To understand this, picture the universe as it once was, before stars, before galaxies, even before atoms. A swirling sea of energy, chaotic and immense, where the forces that now govern reality, gravity, electromagnetism, the nuclear forces, were not yet distinct. In such a state, one could imagine a region denser than the rest, its gravity creating an imbalance, pulling matter toward it before the universe underwent its extraordinary phase of rapid expansion known as cosmic inflation. As inflation stretched the very fabric of space, this dense region might have been flung far beyond the observable universe, like a leaf carried by a gale. Yet its influence, its gravitational pull, could still linger, shaping the motions of galaxies even now. It is a possibility, that carries a certain elegance, though it raises profound questions. Why would such a dense region exist? What caused it to form? Does its presence suggest that the universe, far from being uniform, is a patchwork of density and void, of order and chaos? Others might venture even further, suggesting that dark flow could be evidence of the multiverse, a concept as thrilling as it is bewildering. Imagine, for a moment, that our universe is but one bubble in an infinite cosmic foam. Each bubble, a universe unto itself, governed by its own laws of physics, its own constants, its own peculiarities. If this is so, then perhaps the gravitational Titan drawing galaxies toward it lies within another bubble, pressing against the edge of our own. Yet such an idea, as enticing as it may be, invites even more questions. How might such a universe exert a force on ours? Are these bubbles truly separate, or are they connected by some deeper fabric, some underlying reality that binds them together? And if the multiverse exists, what does it mean for us? Could it be that our universe, as immense as it seems, is but one small piece of a far greater whole? Or might it be that we are unique in ways we cannot yet comprehend? There are, of course, more cautious explanations, those that remain closer to home. Some suggest that the motion of these galaxy clusters could be explained by forces within our own observable universe, subtle, unseen forces, perhaps, but ones that do not require anything beyond the horizon. In this view, dark flow might be less a glimpse into the great beyond and more a puzzle to solve within the universe we already know. Reflecting on these possibilities, one might feel torn between the appeal of simplicity and the allure of the unknown. A scientist might seek explanations that fit neatly within the framework of current knowledge, favoring the elegance of a solution grounded in what we already understand. A philosopher, however, might revel in the mystery itself, seeing dark flow not as a problem to solve, but as an invitation to imagine what lies beyond. And so, one might wonder, what could be pulling these galaxies? What lies beyond the horizon, waiting to be discovered, or perhaps forever out of reach? Such questions do not demand definitive answers. Instead, they invite contemplation, a stretching of the mind toward the edges of comprehension. They remind us that the universe is not merely a collection of facts, but a living story, one that unfolds with every new observation. As we ponder these gravitational titans, we are left with both wonder and humility. Perhaps we will one day know what lies beyond, or perhaps dark flow will remain forever a mystery, a whisper from the farthest reaches of the cosmos. Either way, the act of asking, of seeking, is itself a profound thing. And so we continue our journey into the unknown, turning now to one of the most extraordinary events in the history of the universe, the moment when space itself expanded faster than light, carrying with it the seeds of everything we see today. Cosmic inflation may hold the key to understanding dark flow, and much more besides. If one were to imagine the birth of the universe, the image might be one of chaos, a seething primordial sea of energy, untamed and unstructured. But what if, amidst this chaos, there was an event so extraordinary, so rapid, that it shaped the universe we know in the blink of an eye, This is the story of cosmic inflation, a moment so brief yet so profound that it has become one of the cornerstones of modern cosmology. To understand cosmic inflation, one must first consider a problem that puzzled scientists for decades. Why is the universe so uniform? On the largest scales, when one looks at the cosmic microwave background, the faint afterglow of the Big Bang, it appears remarkably smooth. The temperature and density are almost identical no matter where one looks, even in regions that should never have had the chance to interact. This is known as the horizon problem. How could such distant parts of the universe come to be so similar? In the 1980s, a physicist named Alan Guth proposed a solution. He suggested that in the earliest moments of the universe's existence, there was a period of incredibly rapid expansion, a moment when the fabric of space itself ballooned outward faster than the speed of light. In this brief instant, which lasted no more than a fraction of a second, the universe grew exponentially, smoothing out any irregularities like batter spread evenly across a pan. The idea was radical, but it addressed not only the horizon problem, but several other puzzles in cosmology as well. Now imagine this process. Picture a droplet of water, quivering with potential energy. In an instant, it expands, faster than one can comprehend, until it fills the size of a galaxy. This is the essence of cosmic inflation. The universe, once unimaginably small, became vast in an instant, setting the stage for everything that would follow. During this time, the universe was governed not by stars or galaxies, but by fields of energy, one of which is theorized to have driven inflation itself. This inflaton field, as it is called, existed in a high energy state, like a ball perched on a hilltop. As the ball rolled down into a lower energy state, it released an immense amount of energy, fueling the rapid expansion of space. This energy, in turn, created the particles that would eventually form atoms, stars, and galaxies. It was, in essence, the universe's grand opening act. The implications of inflation are profound. It explains not only the uniformity of the universe, but also its vastness. Without inflation, the observable universe would be a tiny fraction of what we see today. Inflation also suggests that what we observe, the galaxies, the stars, the clusters of matter, is only a small piece of a much larger whole. Beyond our observable universe may lie regions shaped by the same inflationary process, each with its own characteristics, its own histories. Reflecting on this, one might marvel at the elegance of the theory. Cosmic inflation is a unifying idea, one that ties together disparate observations and makes sense of the universe's earliest moments. And yet, it also raises profound questions. If inflation occurred, what triggered it? What caused the inflaton field to exist in the first place? And if inflation shaped our universe, might it also have given rise to others? Here, a philosopher might pause and ponder the implications of a multiverse. If inflation is responsible for creating multiple bubbles of reality, does this diminish the significance of our own universe? Or does it enhance it, suggesting that even in a sea of infinite possibilities we exist, and we are here to ask these questions? A scientist, on the other hand, might marvel at the precision required for inflation to occur as it did. The parameters of the inflaton field, the timing of its decay, all of these had to align perfectly to create a universe capable of sustaining life. Is this sheer coincidence, or is there something deeper at work, some principle or force that we have yet to understand? As one reflects on inflation, it becomes clear that it is not merely a story of the past. Its effects ripple through the present, shaping the structure of the cosmos, the distribution of matter, and perhaps even the mysteries of dark flow. If a dense region of space existed before inflation, pulling matter toward it, then inflation might have carried this region far beyond our observable universe, leaving behind a gravitational echo, a subtle tug that we now observe as the drift of galaxy clusters. And so, inflation is not merely a theory, it is a lens through which one can glimpse the extraordinary interconnectedness of all things. It ties the smallest particle to the largest galaxy, the briefest moment to the vast stretches of time. It reminds us that the universe, for all its complexity, is built on simple principles: expansion, energy, balance, and that within these principles lies the potential for endless wonder. As we move forward, let us carry the story of inflation with us, for it offers a foundation upon which many mysteries rest. And in the next step of our journey, we shall examine one of these mysteries in greater detail: the question of uniformity. Is the universe truly as smooth and balanced as inflation suggests? Or does dark flow hint at a deeper complexity, one that challenges the very idea of a homogeneous cosmos? Uniformity. The very word suggests balance, a soothing harmony that extends across the vastness of space. When one gazes at the cosmos on its larger scales, there is a certain simplicity, a sameness, if you will, that emerges. Galaxies are distributed in great filaments and clusters, but step far enough back, and these intricate details blur into a smooth, homogeneous expanse. This is the foundation of our understanding of the universe, that it is, on the whole, both homogeneous and isotropic. In other words, matter is evenly distributed, and the universe looks roughly the same in every direction. But, as with so many ideas in science, this notion of uniformity is not without its challenges. And dark flow, that enigmatic motion of galaxy clusters toward an unseen point, stands as one of the most provocative challenges of all. Reflecting on this, one might ask, is the universe truly as uniform as it appears? Or have we, in our desire for simplicity, overlooked something fundamental, an underlying complexity that disrupts the cosmic balance? A philosopher might argue that the very concept of uniformity is a construct of the human mind, a lens through which we seek to impose order on the chaos of reality. A scientist, by contrast, might point to the overwhelming evidence in favor of homogeneity, the smoothness of the cosmic microwave background, the large-scale distribution of galaxies, the consistency of physical laws across space and time. And yet, dark flow remains. If galaxy clusters are drifting in unison toward a point near Centaurus and Hydra, then this motion suggests a gravitational force that defies the principle of uniformity. For such a force to exist, it would require an immense concentration of mass far beyond what is visible within the observable universe. One might imagine a great cosmic imbalance, a dense region of space that exerts its pull across billions of light years, creating ripples in the smooth fabric of the cosmos. This, of course, raises a profound question. If the universe is not uniform beyond the observable horizon, then what does that mean for our understanding of its origins? Cosmic inflation, that extraordinary burst of rapid expansion, was proposed in part to explain the universe's homogeneity. If dark flow suggests that the universe is less uniform than inflation predicts, then does this call the theory into question? Or does it point to nuances within inflation itself? an indication that, while the process smoothed much of the universe, it may have left behind subtle traces of the chaos from which it emerged. Here, one might find themselves torn between competing perspectives. A pragmatist might argue that dark flow is an anomaly, a peculiar but ultimately insignificant deviation from the larger pattern of uniformity. After all, the observable universe remains remarkably smooth, its structure consistent with the predictions of inflation. A dreamer, however, might see dark flow as a clue, an invitation to peer deeper into the unknown, to question the very assumptions upon which our cosmological models are built. As one considers these possibilities, it becomes clear that the idea of uniformity is as much a philosophical question as it is a scientific one. What does it mean for the universe to be uniform? Does true balance exist? Or is it an illusion? A fleeting moment of order amidst the ever-changing tides of existence? And if the universe is not uniform, then what lies beyond the observable horizon? Is it a chaotic expanse teeming with irregularities and asymmetries? Or is it something else entirely, a realm governed by principles we have yet to discover? One might wonder, too, about our place within this grand cosmic landscape. If the observable universe is but a small piece of a much larger whole, then might we be uniquely situated, cosmically lucky, one might say, to find ourselves in such a smooth, stable region? Or is it simply that the laws of physics ensure a certain degree of balance, regardless of where one looks? Ultimately, the question of uniformity is one that defies easy answers. It forces us to grapple with the limitations of our knowledge, to confront the boundaries of what we can observe and measure. But it also inspires us to imagine, to wonder, and to seek out new ways of understanding the cosmos. As we move forward, let us carry these questions with us, for they are the heart of what it means to explore. And as we turn our attention to the multiverse, a realm of infinite possibilities, we may find that the answers to these questions lie not within our universe alone, but within the countless others that may exist beyond its bounds. The multiverse. When one looks up at the night sky, it is easy to feel small, insignificant even. The vastness of space, the sheer number of stars and galaxies, is humbling. But what if our universe, the totality of everything we can see, measure, and comprehend, is not the whole story? What if it is merely one bubble in a vast cosmic foam, one among countless others, each with its own rules, its own nature, its own story? This is the idea of the multiverse, a concept that stretches the imagination to its limits. If the multiverse is real, then the universe as we know it is but a single thread in an infinite tapestry, its colors woven together with those of countless other realms, and dark flow, that strange and stubborn motion of galaxy clusters, might be the faintest whisper of another bubble pressing against the edge of our own. To consider the multiverse is to confront the very nature of existence itself. Imagine, if you will, that our universe was born not in isolation, but as part of a larger process, a cosmic inflationary event that created countless bubbles of reality. Each bubble expands, forming its own universe, complete with stars, galaxies, and perhaps even life. Some of these bubbles might resemble ours, with familiar laws of physics and chemistry. Others might be unimaginably different, their rules so alien that one could scarcely conceive of their nature. Reflecting on this, one might wonder, if the multiverse exists, what does it mean for our universe? Are we just one of many? A cosmic coincidence in an infinite sea of possibilities? Or is there something unique about our bubble, something that sets it apart from the rest? A scientist might see the multiverse as a natural extension of inflation theory. If inflation occurred, rapidly expanding space-time to form our universe, then it stands to reason that it could have created others as well. The mathematics of inflation even predicts this, suggesting that the process of bubble formation is ongoing, an eternal cycle of creation and expansion. Within this framework, dark flow could be the result of gravitational interactions between our bubble and a neighboring one, evidence of a multiverse brushing against its boundaries. A philosopher, however, might pause to consider the implications of such an idea. If infinite universes exist, then does that not render our own less significant? In an infinite multiverse, every possibility would be realized, every decision, every chance event, played out in countless variations. If this is so, then what does it mean to be unique? What does it mean to be real? But perhaps this line of thought misses something essential. The multiverse, if it exists, does not diminish the value of our universe. Instead, it enriches it, placing it within a larger context, a grander story. The existence of countless other bubbles does not make ours any less wondrous. If anything, it makes the act of being here, of observing and questioning, all the more extraordinary. And yet, the multiverse remains a theory. Fascinating, compelling, but unproven. The evidence for its existence is indirect, tied to the mathematics of inflation and the peculiarities of dark flow. One might imagine it as a horizon, tantalizingly close yet forever out of reach. If the multiverse is real, it lies beyond the boundaries of our observation, its secrets hidden within the infinite expanse of space-time. As one ponders this, it becomes clear that the multiverse is as much a philosophical concept as it is a scientific one. It forces us to grapple with questions of identity, meaning, and existence. If there are infinite versions of you, living out every possible variation of your life, then what does it mean to be you? And if our universe is but one among many, then what does it mean to call it the universe at all? These questions have no easy answers, but perhaps that is the point. The multiverse, like so much of cosmology, challenges us to think beyond the familiar, to stretch our minds to the limits of imagination. It reminds us that the act of questioning is as valuable as the answers we seek. As we consider the multiverse and its implications, let us not lose sight of what makes our universe unique. It is the one we know, the one we inhabit, the one that allows us to ask these questions. Whether we are alone in the cosmos or one among countless bubbles, the fact remains that we are here and we are curious. And so, as we prepare to delve deeper into the mysteries of the cosmos, let us carry this curiosity with us. For in the vast expanse of space and time, it is curiosity that lights our way, guiding us toward the answers that lie just beyond the horizon. When one gazes at the night sky, what does one see? stars, of course, scattered like glittering jewels against the velvet darkness. But what does one imagine? For some, those stars are destinations, points of light on a map waiting to be explored. For others, they are symbols, reminders of our place in the cosmos. And for a fortunate few, they are questions, each one a doorway into a world of possibility. Imagination, one might argue, is the unsung hero of science. It is the spark that lights the fire of curiosity, the force that drives humanity to ask questions no one has thought to ask before. Without imagination, the stars would be mere points of light, the universe a series of numbers and equations devoid of meaning. It is imagination that gives science its power, transforming cold data into grand narratives, possibilities into realities. Reflecting on this, one might consider the great scientific minds of history. Isaac Newton, gazing at an apple, imagined the invisible hand of gravity stretching across the cosmos. Albert Einstein, pondering the nature of light, envisioned space and time as a single, malleable fabric. And Alan Guth, facing the riddle of the universe's uniformity, imagined a moment of inflation, a burst of expansion so rapid it defied comprehension. Imagination, however, is not the antithesis of reason. It is its companion. A scientist might imagine a world where light bends under the pull of gravity, but it is through rigorous observation and experimentation that this becomes the theory of general relativity. A philosopher might imagine a multiverse, but it is through mathematical models and logical reasoning that this concept gains credence in the realm of physics. One might wonder, then, how imagination has shaped our understanding of the cosmos. Consider the phenomenon of dark flow. Without imagination, it might have been dismissed as an anomaly, a quirk of the data to be ignored. But imagination transforms it into a question, a possibility, a mystery that beckons us to explore. Is it a gravitational echo of a region beyond the cosmic horizon, a sign of a neighboring universe brushing against our own, or something else entirely, something we have yet to conceive? A philosopher might suggest that imagination is the bridge between what we know and what we yearn to understand. It allows us to step beyond the limits of observation, to envision what might lie beyond the edge of the observable universe. A scientist, meanwhile, might emphasize the importance of discipline, of grounding imagination in the realities of evidence and theory. Together, these perspectives create a dynamic interplay, a dance, if you will, between the known and the unknown. Reflecting further, one might ask, why is imagination so essential to our pursuit of knowledge? Perhaps it is because the universe is not static. It is not a closed book, its chapters written and complete. Instead, it is a living story, one that unfolds with every new discovery, every new question. Imagination allows us to participate in this story, to be not just observers, but creators, shaping our understanding of the cosmos through the questions we ask and the answers we seek. One might also consider the role of imagination in inspiring future generations. When a child gazes at the stars and imagines traveling to distant galaxies, they are not merely dreaming, they are laying the foundation for the discoveries of tomorrow. Imagination, in this sense, is a gift passed down through the ages, a legacy that connects the stargazers of antiquity with the scientists and philosophers of today. As we ponder the mysteries of the universe, let us not forget the importance of imagination. It is the engine of discovery, the force that propels us forward, even when the path ahead is shrouded in darkness. It reminds us that science is not just a collection of facts, but a journey, a process of exploration and wonder. And so, as we prepare to confront the question of meaning, the grandest question of all, let us carry this imaginative spirit with us. For in the vast expanse of the cosmos, it is imagination that transforms the ordinary into the extraordinary, the unknown into the knowable, and the finite into the infinite. As we gaze out into the universe, into its immeasurable vastness and its mysteries that seem to stretch without end, one question arises, quietly but persistently. What does it all mean? This is not a question that science alone can answer, nor one that philosophy can claim to resolve definitively. It is a question that lies at the intersection of knowledge and wonder, of discovery and introspection. It is perhaps the most human question of all. Consider for a moment the scale of the universe. Billions of galaxies, each containing billions of stars, scattered across an expanse so vast that even light, traveling at its remarkable speed, cannot traverse it in a human lifetime. In the face of such enormity, one might be tempted to feel insignificant, a mere speck of dust in the grand cosmic tableau. But does vastness necessarily diminish meaning, or might it enhance it, placing our existence within a larger, more intricate framework? A scientist might approach this question by considering the universe as a system, governed by laws of physics that are, as far as we can tell, universal. From the smallest particle to the largest galaxy, these laws create order from chaos, giving rise to stars, planets, and, ultimately, life. One might find meaning in this order, in the fact that we are products of the same processes that shape the cosmos. Every atom in our bodies, forged in the heart of a distant star, connects us to the universe in a profound and tangible way. A philosopher, on the other hand, might reflect on the role of human consciousness in assigning meaning to the universe. Without us, the stars would burn unnoticed, the galaxies would drift in silence, their beauty unobserved. Does this make us cosmic interpreters, endowing the universe with significance through our awareness of it? Or does it merely reflect the limits of our perspective, our tendency to see ourselves as central to a story that may not, in fact, be about us at all? Reflecting further, one might ask, is meaning something to be discovered, like a hidden treasure, or something to be created, an act of imagination and will? If it is the latter, then perhaps the search for meaning is itself the answer. To question, to explore, to wonder, these are acts of creation, moments where we bring meaning into existence, even in the face of uncertainty. Some might find meaning in the interconnectedness of all things, in the way that the universe's intricate web of cause and effect links every particle, every star, every life. Others might find it in the act of discovery, in the pursuit of knowledge that drives us to peer beyond the horizon and ask what lies beyond. And still others might find it in the simple, profound fact of existence itself, in the recognition that we are here, that we are conscious, that we are capable of asking these questions at all. But the question of meaning is not one that science or philosophy can answer alone. It is a deeply personal inquiry, one that each individual must confront in their own way. For some, the vastness of the cosmos might inspire awe, a sense of being part of something greater. For others, it might evoke a longing for connection, a desire to find purpose amidst the apparent indifference of the universe. As one reflects on this, it becomes clear that the search for meaning is as much about the journey as it is about the destination. The act of asking the question, of seeking to understand, is itself a form of meaning, a way of engaging with the universe that affirms our place within it. Whether we find answers or not, the search reminds us of our humanity, our curiosity, our capacity for wonder. And so, as we approach the end of our journey, let us carry this question with us, not as a burden, but as a companion. For in the vast expanse of space and time, meaning is not something to be given, but something to be made. It is the act of looking up at the stars, of wondering what lies beyond, of seeking to know and understand. And in that act, we find not just meaning, but something even more profound. The affirmation that against all odds, we are here and we are asking. As we conclude, let us reflect on what we have explored. The mysteries of the observable universe, the edge of the cosmic horizon, the tantalizing possibilities of dark flow and the multiverse. All of these are pieces of a larger story. A story not just about the universe, but about us. For every question we ask of the cosmos is, in some sense, a question we ask of ourselves. And so, we arrive at the edge of our journey, much as we began, with a question. What lies beyond the observable universe? We have ventured through the boundaries of light and time, pondered the mysteries of dark flow and the multiverse, and considered the very fabric of the cosmos itself. Along the way, we have encountered not just answers, but more questions, more possibilities, more reasons to wonder. As we conclude, one might reflect on the nature of these boundaries. The observable universe, the cosmic horizon, the edge of knowledge, these are not barriers that halt our progress. They are invitations. Invitations to imagine what might lie beyond, to question what we think we know, and to embrace the mystery of the unknown. Imagine for a moment the ancient stargazers who first looked to the heavens. They had no telescopes, no theories of relativity, no knowledge of cosmic inflation. Yet they gazed upward, their imaginations kindled by the flickering light of distant stars. To them, the universe was a canvas, vast and untouchable, and yet their curiosity transformed it into a story of gods and constellations, of creation and eternity. We too are storytellers. We may arm ourselves with equations and observations, but at our core, we are no different from those early stargazers. For every boundary we encounter, we ask the same questions. What lies beyond? What does it mean? How does it connect to us? A philosopher might say that the act of questioning is itself an affirmation of our humanity. It is through our questions that we engage with the universe, that we bridge the gap between the finite and the infinite. A scientist might add that these questions drive progress, pushing us to explore, to innovate, to uncover the truths hidden in the fabric of reality. And yet, as we stand at the edge of the known, one might ask, are we not, in some sense, already beyond it? Every question we ask, every theory we propose, is an act of reaching into the unknown. When we imagine what lies beyond the observable universe, we are already stepping into that realm, guided not by sight, but by reason and wonder. Reflecting on this, one might consider the nature of progress itself. Each time humanity pushes back a boundary, whether it be the horizon of the observable universe or the limits of understanding, a new one emerges. The darkness retreats, yes, but it never disappears. It is infinite, inexhaustible, always inviting us onward. This is not a failure, but a gift, a reminder that the universe is vast enough to sustain our curiosity for all time. So, what lies beyond the observable universe? Perhaps it is a continuation of the familiar. More galaxies, more stars, more of the cosmic dance we have come to know. Or perhaps it is something entirely different, something so extraordinary that it defies our current understanding. We do not know. But in this unknowing, there is beauty. For the act of wondering, of imagining, of seeking to know is itself a profound affirmation of life. As one reflects on the journey we have taken, it becomes clear that the questions we ask of the universe are, in many ways, questions we ask of ourselves. What are our limits? What are our possibilities? How do we make sense of our place in the grand expanse of existence? These are not questions that require answers. They are questions that invite us to live, to explore, to dream. And so, as we conclude this journey, let us carry these questions with us, not as burdens, but as gifts. For in the end, the universe is not just a collection of stars and galaxies. It is a mirror, reflecting our curiosity, our wonder, our endless drive to understand. And as we gaze into that mirror, we find not just the cosmos, but ourselves, staring back with the light of the stars in our eyes. The edge of the universe, like the edge of our knowledge, is not an ending. It is a beginning of new questions, new discoveries, new wonders yet to be revealed. And though we may never reach the horizon, the act of moving toward it, of striving to know what lies beyond, is itself the greatest journey of all. Afterward, a conversation between science and philosophy. As we conclude this journey through the mysteries of the universe, one might find themselves returning to the question that began it all. What lies beyond the edge of the observable universe? We have examined the science, weighed the evidence, and indulged in the philosophical wonder that surrounds it. And yet, for all the equations and metaphors, the theories and reflections, the answer remains elusive. Perhaps that is as it should be. For as I suggested earlier, it is not the reaching of the horizon that matters most, but the striving toward it. The road, the questions, the endless curiosity. These are what propel us forward. But what is it, one might ask, that truly drives this striving? What keeps us peering into the unknown generation after generation? I would suggest that it is the dynamic interplay between two forces, science and philosophy. Together, they form a partnership as old as humanity's first questions, one that has propelled us to the stars and beyond. Science, with its tools and measurements, charts the path. Philosophy, with its imagination and introspection, illuminates the destination. And like any good partnership, theirs is not without its arguments. Indeed, one might liken their relationship to that of a married couple. Two personalities so distinct and yet so deeply intertwined that one cannot function fully without the other. Science provides rigor, precision, and evidence, but risks becoming sterile without the wonder and creativity that philosophy provides. Philosophy, for its part, dreams boldly, but needs science to anchor its musings in reality. I once imagined this relationship as a conversation, a moment, perhaps, in a quiet study where these two voices come alive. Science, the logical and meticulous partner, sits surrounded by notes and papers, ever eager to organize and classify. Philosophy, more whimsical but no less sharp, stirs her tea, gazing out of the window at the stars. The conversation might go something like this. Science begins, of course, with a statement of certainty, dismissing dark flow as nothing more than a statistical anomaly. "I've run the numbers," he says, adjusting his spectacles. "Checked the data twice. There's no need to speculate about multiverses or bubbles brushing against one another. It's also speculative." Philosophy, standing by the window, arches an eyebrow. "And inflation," she counters, "isn't speculative. That grand cosmic expansion of yours, an event that unfolded faster than light in a fraction of a second, sounds rather fanciful to me." Science splutters. "Inflation is supported by observable evidence, the uniformity of the cosmic microwave background, the distribution of galaxies. It's elegant, predictive, grounded." "And," philosophy says, turning toward him with a knowing smile, "it began as a question, did it not? A question born not of evidence, but of imagination, just like the multiverse, just like dark flow. You see, my dear, you and I are not so different." Science, always a touch defensive, straightens his notes. "I deal in facts, philosophy, hard evidence. Your musings, however charming, lack rigor." Philosophy laughs softly. "And yet, without my musings, where would your facts come from? Who first dared to imagine that light might bend, that space might curve, that time itself might be flexible? You call it theory, science. But theory is nothing more than imagination disciplined into form." Science pauses, caught between irritation and reluctant admiration. He adjusts his spectacles again, a gesture more habit than necessity. "Perhaps," he concedes, "but your imagination must know its limits. You cannot simply dream without regard for the measurable." "And you," philosophy replies, her tone softening, "must learn to dream at all. The universe is vast, science far greater than our instruments can yet measure. It invites us not only to study, but to wonder. You chart the stars, and I give them meaning. Together, we make sense of the cosmos." For a moment, the study falls silent. Then science leans back, his expression thoughtful. "You are insufferable," he says, almost fondly. Philosophy raises her teacup in a mock toast. "And you, my dear, are utterly maddening. But," she adds, her gaze turning back to the stars, "what would one of us be without the other?" As I imagine this dialogue, I find myself smiling, for in their sparring, their banter, there is a deeper truth. Science and philosophy, though seemingly at odds, are inseparable. Their partnership is not one of agreement, but of tension, of challenge, of mutual inspiration. And it is this dynamic, this ever-evolving dance between knowledge and wonder, that drives humanity forward. And so, as we end this journey, let us carry their voices with us. The precision of science and the imagination of philosophy, each sharpening and tempering the other. For it is in their union, their collaboration, that we find our greatest strength. Together, they are the flame that lights our way, the force that propels us toward the horizon. What lies beyond that horizon, we may never know. But as long as science and philosophy walk this road together, hand in hand, we will continue to seek, to wonder, and to discover. And perhaps one day, we will see what lies beyond. The End.
Thank you for listening to What is Outside the Observable Universe by Sascha Schmidt. We hope you enjoyed this journey into science and philosophy. If you'd like to explore more timeless stories, be sure to visit our channel, where you'll find a wide selection of audiobooks ranging from science fiction to adventure, non-fiction, documentary, and more. If you enjoyed this audiobook, don't forget to like the video, subscribe to the channel, and leave a comment letting us know which stories you'd like to hear next. Your engagement helps us continue to bring classic literature to life for listeners like you. Visit our channel page to discover more great audiobooks that may pique your interest. Thank you again for listening, and we look forward to having you with us on our next adventure.